much. So I think there's a lot of benefit there and putting it on our website. And then I think there's ways we can incorporate you guys, if you're interested as you move forward, the ones that aren't graduating, that maybe, you know, in different events that we do, to have you come in and present your results. But I mean, if this all started as us kind of being the client and you guys working for us on this issue to give you real world experience, and I think I'm blown away. You really did an amazing job. To just the complexity of getting goods to the marketplace that people don't understand, and the harm is that these are problems for the trucking companies to meet all the regulations and pay all the fees and all that kind of stuff. That's a burden to our competitiveness. But then when you go beyond, like, we get involved in a lot of freight technology pilot projects, trying to develop communication platforms to be able to assist trucks to get to their final destination on time and all sorts of things. It's just, and there's so much overlap and interrelation between funding and state versus federal, whose responsibility is it? It's very, very complex, and it's highly political. That's why I would have thought transportation would be super boring when I was growing up. And then you get into it, though, and it's not boring at all, because it's what everybody wants to get their hands on. So it's a great, just to give you some unsolicited advice, I mean, as you're moving forward, it's a great area for a career, because these problems are going to be around for another 500 years. And if you're able to get a niche in there where you can be seen to be trying to solve them, it's good stuff. And it's very necessary and needed. But great job. Totally.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
We have capacity to know that.
We still have funds.
I had another.
Just talking about this. And maybe
it'll
like a
5-year
show.
Oh, that would be
nice. There was a dry run done last week at the Bush School. They were even better this week than last week. They were pretty good last week. TTI came over, and they had the folks who do video for the Bush School. So we do have some existing footage that's already, we can talk about perhaps make use of somehow.
That would be great, and we'd love to have, we can send out the video to our network, we could also put it on our website and encourage people to go to it and watch the videos.
Right.
So
we have a video right
now
going
great.
On, so.
Yeah, okay.
The
more the merrier. And there are also both of the, you're hoping that you will get the final report at the same time that they walk across the stage.
Yeah.
That's pretty much just, I think, the time frame.
And that's their goal.
We weren't in Washington.
The
we'll be here too.
The one
you want to
be
excited
for something. You expect for both the reports.
Okay.
Because clearly you need something in addition. They recognize you need something in addition to the 80-page.
Yes, an executive summary would be great, because then we can send that. Some of our members will say, send me more, I want the whole thing.
Yeah.
Other members will get a good benefit out of reading the executive summary. Some of them won't read it at all, but I mean, that's just how life is. So.
I don't think I need to walk around anymore. I've called it right here.
Stationary.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, then we're going to go ahead and start with the second part of this presentation. And the other thing we studied, Buy American legislation this year. And the most important takeaways from our presentation today are that the United States government has an extensive and very complicated set of regulations that mandate that U.S. federal agencies and their procurement favor United States sources of products. And this body of legislation has advantages and it has disadvantages, but the advantages could be achieved through more targeted and less distortionary policies. And thus, we will recommend that this legislation should be removed in the majority of it, but it should also be replaced by policies that will achieve the advantages that are less distortionary. And so we'll start by overviewing what this body of legislation is. And the most technical name for it is domestic preference legislation. But we will call it by America legislation, because that just makes more sense, it's more intuitive. And the Buy American Act of 1933 is the first of this legislation that is still in place today. And it was enacted during the Great Depression to try and combat the effects of the Great Depression. But it was at the very end of a time period in history where the U.S. was very protectionist. After this point, we quickly became the world leader in free trade, pushing the entire world towards free trade, and this suddenly became very hypocritical that we still have this act in place. And then there's the Berry Amendment of 1941. This amendment was for the Department of Defense, and it was much stricter than the Buy American legislation as a whole, but for security reasons. And then there's the Buy America Acts of 1982, to be differentiated from Buy American, and just to make it more confusing. And these acts, they apply only to the Department of Transportation, and that's because that department makes grants to state and local agencies for their transportation projects, and thus it didn't fall under the Buy American Act, which is about procurement. And so it applies some of the same ideas to the Department of Transportation. And then the latest temporary act, which had a Buy American component, was the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, or the ARRA, of 2009. And this was the stimulus package that was used to try and combat the effects of the Great Recession. And it said that all the funds through it had to be to procure things that were made in the United States. And there are many more. Every single Congress since 1933 has enacted some form of Buy American legislation. And so there's a great body of it applying each to different products within different thresholds, and it's very complicated. And so in analyzing this body of legislation, we came up with some goals for what the policy recommendation would look like. And the first is economic efficiency. So the either this or the alternative to it that we would select should be economically efficient and as little distortionary as possible. And then we looked at distribution of benefits, so which segments of the population are harmed or benefited, and trying to make it equitable between those as much as possible. And then political feasibility, so you can't choose a recommendation that can never happen. And so looking at political feasibility, it's how likely is this to actually be capable of passing. And so I'm going to go through the stakeholders, who are the people or organizations that benefit or are harmed by a policy. And we'll start with the domestic stakeholders.
Many hands make light work. What isn't true?
And so the domestic stakeholders are those that are operating within the United States. And the producers, they can be of any nationality, but producers, firms that are producing products within the borders of the United States, they are benefited from Buy American legislation because they are artificially insulated from competition from abroad. But they are only benefited under three criteria. First, that foreign producers would want to sell the U.S. government, which it's very complicated to go through the Federal Acquisition Regulation, the FAR, which has almost 2,000 pages. And also there's a language barrier for many countries. So some, they just might not be interested. We don't know how to tell exactly the hypothetical. And so if foreign firms or firms operating in foreign countries would want to sell to the U.S. government, then this policy benefits domestic producers. And then secondly, if there's limited domestic competition. So if there are many domestic producers that would want to sell the U.S. government, then that'll drive down prices, and it's about the same as if they were also international. It's not as beneficial to producers in that case. And then third, if the U.S. government is an important buyer of a particular product. So if a product, you can sell it to 1,000 different companies or the U.S. government, then it doesn't really matter that much to a company whether they sell to the U.S. government. So if those three conditions are met, then this benefits U.S. producers because they are insulated from their competition. But on the other hand, it has different effects on the United States public. So some of the public, they just support buying things in America, whether or not it's higher prices and lower quality. They don't really care about the effects on the economy because it appeals to their sense of patriotism. And we found that there are five determinants of whether they take that attitude towards protectionist legislation despite the economic effects. And the first is how the economy is doing. So when the economy does worse, people tend more towards protectionism. And the second and third, education and income, lower educated, lower income people prefer protectionism. And that's often because, as I'll show you later, low income people and low educated people are the ones that are harmed by free trade. They're the ones whose jobs tend to be lost. And so they're more likely to support protectionism for that reason. Political party, this actually has varied from election to election, but usually there's a correlation between someone's political party and their preferences towards trade. And then age, so older Americans are more likely to have protectionist tendencies. Next, we get to the government. And elected government officials in the United States respond to their constituencies, which differ based on whether they have more producers that would be affected versus if they have more consumers that would be affected. And so that differs from elected official to elected official. And then next are the foreign. So those outside the United States that are producing products elsewhere. And there are actually 129 countries that are exempt. So they are treated as if their products were made in the US. They're given equal consideration for federal procurement. And for those 129 countries that are exempt, their preferences look about like our preferences within the United States. Their producers, under the assumption that they choose to sell the US government, that they do want to go through all that regulation in the FAR, and they want to sell the US government, and under the assumption that the United States is an important, the government is an important buyer of their products, then this benefits them because they are also insulated from competition, just like US producers. And similarly, it has two effects on the public there. So the public of those countries, it could benefit for working for companies that are insulated if they're employed by them. At the same time, they can be harmed if those companies, because they're able to sell to the US government, they raise prices on goods that the public would want, and then the public would be harmed. So it goes both ways for the public of those countries. And then the government, it depends on the political structure from country to country. So whether it's more responsive to the public or to the producers. And then there are the non-exempt countries, those that are not one of the 129, and they are barred from selling to the US government. And under the assumptions, again, that they actually would want to, which is a hypothetical, we can't see whether they would decide to or not in the absence of this legislation, then, and also under the assumption that selling to the US government is one of the main buyers. They can't just go sell to someone else instead. Then the producers are harmed because they're unable to do something that would be profitable. The public, it goes both ways. They could be employed by those producers and they're not, so that's a harm, but at the same time, those producers have to have lower prices for products because they have less buyers, and so the public is helped by having lower prices for products they want, assuming that it is a product that could be sold to the public. So it depends from everything, for every product. And then the government, again, it depends on the political structure. If it's a government that responds more to its constituencies that are industries versus the public, what their preferences are. And now we will hand it off to the disadvantages.
So I'm going to talk about the disadvantages and advantages of this legislation. And the first disadvantage is economic efficiency. But this legislation is economically inefficient because goods that could be purchased at a lower price from other countries are instead purchased at a higher price here in the United States. Supply and demand analysis shows that domestic producers are benefit from this situation. However, the loss of buying power that the U.S. experiences in this situation will exceed the domestic producers' gains. And the result is the nation as a whole will lose. Some other potential effects are higher unemployment, uncompetitive prices for goods, higher debt, and a limited choice of goods. International producers are also negatively affected because this legislation is by definition discriminatory. And it undermines aid efforts because it contributes to poverty in other countries that can't sell to the United States. Last, Buy America legislation. Because the legislation only applies to the last two stages of production, outside producers or domestic producers have to put their products through two stages of production here in the United States in order to sell to the United States. So it creates these extra stages of production that's just wasteful. Next is international relations. So Buy American legislation creates the potential for retaliatory legislation. The Center for Trade and Economic Integration describes protectionist policies as contagious, stating that once a country enacts protectionist policies, others are likely to follow. It also engenders resentment towards the United States. The Gray Report commissioned by President Eisenhower found that legislation is in direct conflict with the basic foreign economic policies of the United States. Lastly, it strains trade agreements. The U.S. has been sued many times by producers in other countries for discriminatory application of its legislation during bidding process. Another disadvantage is federal deficits. This legislation mandates that the U.S. pay more for goods, therefore increasing deficits. The cost of these deficits must be borne by one of three groups: the taxpayers, recipients of government services who experience a decrease in those government services, and people dependent upon the stability of the U.S. economy. Last, the Randall Commission found that Buy American legislation costs the U.S. government up to $100 million annually in higher prices, and also another $100 million in foregone customs revenues. The next category is our impact number that we calculated. So in seeking to evaluate the magnitude of the impact on deficits, we estimated the maximum possible impact using 2007 data from the Federal Procurement Data System. And our research indicates that the maximum cost of Buy American legislation is $2 billion. The last disadvantage is the ambiguity of the application of the legislation. And I will address this in the next section, talking about domestic case law with U.S. versus rural industries. So now I'm going to talk about some of the advantages of Buy America legislation. The first one is that it provides a boost to essential or faltering industries. It allows a domestic industry protected access to government contracts. If an industry is perceived to be under temporary stress, a boost in the form of federal purchases of its products is seen as a way to keep these firms in business until the market recovers. Another thing it can do is it acts as a shelter to protect industries that are not able to compete at a level on an international level. And the next advantage is we can use it to gain an edge on international trade. So because the U.S. accounts for a large amount of the world's supply and demand of a product, it can influence the world price of the product. Then it can use trade barriers to extract value from the rest of the world, increasing our profits at the expense of everyone else. And also, it improves the U.S.'s balance of payments by decreasing imports. The next advantage is patriotism. So this is unrelated to economics, but some Americans take pride in American goods. And also, some people are willing to pay more for goods made in America, even though they may not be of a higher quality. Next is security. This is a talked about a lot for support of the legislation. And the idea is, if the U.S. were to enter a war with a country that supplied a crucial product to us, we may not be able to access that product if we did not produce it domestically. And the last advantage is to distribute wealth to America's working class. Buy America legislation is a mechanism to redistribute wealth to low-skilled workers. Because free trade has led to an erosion of the U.S. manufacturing sector, and a lot of low-skilled workers have lost their jobs. Restricting trade is a way to seen as a way to keep those jobs in the United States. And that's it for the advantages. I'm going to move on to talk about the domestic case law by discussing United States versus rural industries. Now, there's two reasons why this case is important in our analysis. First, it's the highest level court to decide Buy America legislation. So we see it as a guide to interpret the act. Also, if the case shows that Buy America legislation is unclear as to the term manufacturer and the term component. So, quick history of the case. Rural Industries won a bid to supply hacksaw blades to the GSA, where it certified the blades were domestic end products. Rural purchased thin strips of steel from a foreign company to make the blades. They then cut, flame treated, and painted the blades at their U.S. plant. The government brought an action against Rural Industries under the False Claims Act. It argued that the steel as a component of the blades was not a domestic end product because it accounted for 90% of the blade components. So the blades themselves were not domestic end products. A district court jury found that Rule violated the act, and then the Court of Appeals upheld the district court's ruling. So now I'll talk about the analysis of the case. So in deciding the case, the court first looked at the text of the statute, which states that only such manufactured articles as have been manufactured in the United States substantially from all articles, materials, or supplies mined, produced, or manufactured in the United States shall be acquired for public use. The court determined that this language allows the use of foreign materials so long as they have been subjected to certain amounts of domestic manufacture. And they found that that applies to the last two stages of the act. And then the court defined these stages. So as to the last stage, the end products must have been manufactured in the United States. And as to the next to the last stage, the manufactured end products must have been manufactured from components made in the United States. So the CFR does not define component or manufacturer, so the court looked at some comptroller decisions for some guidance. So in order to determine what is manufacturer in the last stage, the court looked at Comptroller Opinion Number 48 and Henry Davis Walker. And in Comptroller Opinion Number 48, a domestic manufacturer imported Japanese forging and performed three processes domestically. And Henry Davis Walker, a supplier, imported steel rods from Japan and subjected the steel rods to two domestic production practices. Both of these cases satisfied the manufactured in the last stage portion of the test, but they had different outcomes because the court decided differently as to the component portion and the next is the last stage. So then the court looked at what was the definition of component in the next to the last stage. So in doing so, it looked at two other comptroller opinions, Imperial Eastman Court, where the comptroller in that case said, if a manufacturing process performed on material results in a separately identifiable component that is integrated into the end product, the material does not constitute a foreign component. And then the court looked at Orlite Engineering Company, where the comptroller said, the basic test seems to be that if the operations performed on the foreign item create a basically new material or result in a fundamental change in the item prior to incorporation into the end product, it becomes a component manufactured in the United States. So moving on to the conclusion. So after the analysis, the appellate court upheld the decision of the district court and held that the blades were not domestic end products. Because the strips of steel did not qualify as components, like in Davis Walker. And this is important because it shows the legislation isn't clear. Comparing Comptroller Opinion 48 and Davis Walker in this case shows that in three separate circumstances, under a similar set of facts, steel was imported from a foreign country, applied, and there were things done to it, or processes performed on the steel within the United States, and only one of cases was found to satisfy Buy America legislation. And adding to that conclusion, the appellate court stated that whether the product is a domestic end product is a inquiry for the jury as a finder of fact. So this adds to inconsistent results because there's little to guide a jury in their evaluation of the production processes. So in order to, so Davis Walker tried to address the ambiguity. And so the court sent a letter to the director of the Defense Supply Agency to clarify the requirement that the items acquired for public use be manufactured in the United States. But there was no response. And now I'm going to hand it over to Charles to talk about international domestic cases.
Howdy, folks. I'm Charles. So following up with the domestic regulation on the domestic side, we have to be aware that domestic regulation must be in harmony with international treaties that the U.S. has signed on to. So to take us through this puzzle, we'll start off. 1933, we get the Buy American Act that indicates government procurement has to come from American manufacturers. That's the first step. Then in 1948, the GATT Agreement, the General Agreement Against Tariffs and Trade, comes out prohibiting tariffs, domestic preference for private companies, but allowing for government procurement to have their domestic preference. Then going on to 1994, when NAFTA comes into effect, the relevant provision in NAFTA indicates that the United States may consider Canada and Mexico as domestic